This is the story about a weapon that defined the experience of one of Destiny's best DLCs ever, the Taken King. This is a tale of absolute power and accomplishment, and oh boy, lots of grinding to reap the benefits of this weapon. This, my friend, is the tale of the Touch of Malice, the primary exotic scout rifle that really did make the primary slot worth an exotic. So grab a seat, grab a snack and a beverage, cause this one is gonna be a juicy one. Some footage in this video is from players around the community. Their links will be in the description of this video as well as the music too. If this channel keeps popping up in your recommended feed, feel free to hit the sub button. We are really, really close to hitting 60k subarinos, and I think that'll happen sooner rather than later. Thank you guys. I also want to say a special thanks to Datto for helping me with this video as well. Please check him out. He has some dope new merch. Please, please check him out. I have left a timecode to just the weapon quest itself, but I want to talk about the beginning of Destiny 1 and how it was a very different place. Many avenues of difficulty were there, sure, but skewed hard in one direction, like nightfalls and raids, and not much difficulty going on in general activities. The beginning of Destiny 1 also really shifted all of our views of what an exotic weapon was all about. We shifted from primaries are key to galley time, icebreaker baby, fourth horseman, so on and so forth. One important thing to note here in terms of use and weapons was that heavy and special ammo exotics were everything, and especially with icebreaker not needing ammo and regenerating it from nothing, galley just wrecking everything in its path, fourth horseman just bopping bosses with a few final round shots or PS4 people only. Plus, this doesn't even include the fact that Black Hammer, which became Black Spindle, which became Whisper of the Worm, which is now Whisper of the Nerf, was also very strong to use. Fatebringer, a legendary hand cannon, was Arcburn in year 1 and was the perfect hand cannon archetype too. Look, my point here is that nobody was using a primary exotic outside of PvP in a few small encounters where some fit. Everything you needed was really there and was really strong for PvE in year 1 Destiny 1, and that doesn't even include synthesis for your weapons to grab full ammo. It was a very strong and one loadout type of sandbox in Destiny, but that would all change come the update for Gjallarhorn's nerf and year 1's weapons not being able to brought up to year 2 power. So let's talk about it. It's time we talk about power creep for a second. Power creep is when weapons become so powerful that they creep into every activity, including new ones, which makes it hard to have new weapons to begin with and results in players only using the same pool of 3 to 5 for every activity. Think about today's game of Destiny 2. Mountaintop, Recluse, Delirium, Wendigo, etc. Weapons that have come before but are really still the best weapons that we still use in today's game. I bring up power creep for two reasons. Number one, this is what happened to the loadout in year 1 where everyone's Fatebringer, Black Hammer, and Gjallarhorn were no longer allowed to be brought into year 2 activities, and number two, this is all happening again in Destiny 2. What do you think of power creep and how it should be handled? I'll tell you my 2 cents on it. I think power creep is a real problem and should be handled by disabling weapons the way they have and will be doing. I think that the fun of a game like Destiny is starting a new grind for the new best option, or players will get bored of the same 3 to 5 weapons like we have now in Destiny 2. It overall makes new weapons fun to chase and keeps it fresh, at least in my opinion. But let's not harp on Destiny 2 for right now, and instead take a journey back to where we were in Destiny, the Taken King. Weapons were regrinded, sandbox changes were made to make scout rifles stronger, and a new raid was on the horizon, one that was very special to a lot of players and is still their favorite, King's Fall.
You cannot face this alone. 6 of you must rise and stand together. As the king falls.
This raid tested players in almost every way a game like Destiny could have and made for some of the most epic moments in a modern day video game. Seriously, this raid had it all, and the scale alone had lots of players excited to jump into what it had to offer. The final climax of yeeting Oryx sent shockwaves through the community and was the first time the game ever used a mechanic called Final Stand. where the boss had one last push to try to kill you. Something was apparent though. An exotic quest was following you into the raid, and after defeating Oryx, a new quest step popped up. This one was going to be a long one.
What the fuck?
Oh boy. Where do we even begin on this quest? Oh, I know. How about all the way at the start of the Taken King DLC? This quest tasked you with basically exploring everything there was to offer with the Taken King, from killing Brachus, a special Taken Centurion at the bottom of the salt mines in Bunker War 4, all the way down at Rasputin.
They have a bubble.
I don't
Are you f***ing my kid?
He's dead! One is dead! We got one more in the back!
We got one more!
To collecting calcified fragments. Calcified fragments, to speak more in depth on them, were these tiny rock collectibles found around the brand new space, the Dreadnought, a very large but full of activity spaceship orbiting around Saturn. What I loved about the Dreadnought and why I believe it to be the best space ever in Destiny, maybe even better than the Dreaming City, was that it was deceptively closed off. You could almost never run out of activities to do, and we will get to some of those, but yeah, this space made collecting calcified fragments a pleasure. You were going to need 15 fragments to advance to the next step. Then the next step was to beat the raid. Whoa. This was new to Destiny, as the Vex Mythic class had players getting it as a random drop from hard mode, and Crota had players getting a random drop called the Crux of Crota to combine it into a legendary weapon to make Necrochasm. So, you just beat the raid, which was definitely not an easy task without, well, this weapon. Now that you beat the raid, it's time to get the weapon, easy as that, right? Except, nope! Now you were on the Hunger Pain step, which made you collect 25 Worm Spore, 50 Weapon Parts, and 50 Hadium Flakes. This part of the quest to me is the worst part, because while you could always buy the Worm Spore from the Vanguard vendor and Weapon Parts were easy to collect, 50 Hadium Flakes were not easy at all. These were only to be collected by one on the Dreadnought and took forever to find and farm. Players eventually found a circle, but this step was not easy by any stretch. After that, you had to collect even more calcified fragments, this time 30 out of 50 on the Dreadnought. Then do a simple strike, and whoa, there's even more calcified fragments to collect. This time, 45 out of 50. Not to mention, these were time-gated. But how were they time-gated if they were just on the Dreadnought? Well, let me explain. Well, two were from the Nightfalls, which included the Shield Brothers Strike and the Sunless Cell. Five of them were in the raid itself, and about 10 of them were from the Court of Oryx, which was a whole grind of itself. The reason I say time-gated was because sometimes the Nightfall wasn't those two strikes, and Court of Oryx had weekly rotating bosses for Tier 3. Let me put into perspective how crazy the grind was though. Court of Oryx had Tier 1 runes, which dropped anywhere in the world and was like a token to play the easy version of Court of Oryx. Tier 2 required a charge to play, so that meant playing 3 Tier 1 tokens to even charge 1 Tier 2 to play with it. Still with me? Okay. Now, Tier 3, or antiquated runes, meant you had to have 3 Tier 2 charges to make 1 Tier 3 charge. If you failed, you got your token back, but it lost the charge. And these fights were not easy at the time for Tier 3 especially. Oh, and if you think you can just get the rewards because someone else put them in, you are wrong. The fragment only dropped on your rune, so players would sit and wait to put theirs in and beat everyone else in the public event space just to be the first to insert it. Datto actually had a process to speed this up, which he shared with me and probably a lot of you on his guide from the Taken King days. He said, I remember getting a tip on Reddit saying that you could run a duplicate of runes that you needed because you could trade them between characters, speeding up the process much faster. That was the main factor in me getting the gun early. Well, that would have been a lot of help if I didn't already spend weeks regrinding it for this video. Yeah. After that, you were returned to where the Taken King first started, Phobos, and complete the mission Fear's Embrace to kill Marzeek, the Blightcaller, the Taken wizard that spawns when the Echo of Oryx has almost been defeated. Once again, after killing this target, return to Eris, and after the... Nah, I'm just playing this time. You had now the Touch of Malice. Before we get into this weapon, what do you think of exotic quests requiring you to do this much with a final mission to cement it? I personally loved it for this type of exotic, and this is exactly what makes an exotic feel much more special than anything else, to me personally. Alright, now on to the weapon. Touch of Malice was unlike any other weapon in Destiny, and according to the lore book, The Book of Sorrow, Oryx intended for the weapon to be built, and since it was, he was able to maintain his immortality, continuing to feed off the victims of this weapon. Yeah, that is insane, and you definitely feel the wrath of Oryx when you shoot this thing too. With the perk, well, Touch of Malice, the final round of the magazine regenerates and deals bonus damage at the cost of the wielder's life force. So you could keep firing this thing infinitely, and it did heaps of damage, but at the cost of your own health, so you could actually kill yourself with this weapon pretty easily. Also, it had this perk called Eye of the Storm, which made it much more accurate the lower your health got too, and finally a nice perk which was called Touch of Mercy, where after 3 rapid kills with it, the weapon would give you your health right back. Overall, a one-of-a-kind concept that we hadn't seen, and let's not even forget how this weapon could shred through bosses and was a kinetic primary weapon, thus changing the boss kill meta completely. Here's some clips to show you what I mean.
Holy shit.
Oh. That was easy.
I didn't even see your stream of bullets. I thought it
To me, this weapon summed up a raid exotic perfectly. It had a piece of the boss literally inside of the weapon. It had us explore the whole DLC's content and find tons of secrets along the way. And it had us fight some really tough fights to use it. Finally, I think the best part of this weapon is that it is easily the best weapon to use against Oryx, tying the lore perfectly with the exotic itself. Overall, it just slapped. What do you think of Touch of Malice? I would love to hear some stories about the weapon for you, but anyways, let's continue on the story and where we are today with it. Okay, so I don't want to make this section a sad, I want it in Destiny 2 right now type of thing, because there's a couple of reasons for it not being in the game, and I will explain, and Datto actually had some thoughts on this too. Datto says that he doesn't want it to return right now because with Well of Radiance being a thing and now a revamped Sanguine Alchemy, Not sure I'd really like to see Touch of Malice return to the game to stomp over all PvE activities again, although purely from a fan perspective, I wouldn't mind seeing it return. I really couldn't agree more with what Datto said. The Well of Radiance, a super inside of Destiny 2 with the capability to give you full health and an overshield and a damage buff, would make the Touch of Malice perk completely arbitrary, and not to mention with the exotic Sanguine Alchemy, which can give you infinite healing rifts and damage rifts, this could be escalated entirely. We also left behind auto reload mechanics at the beginning of Shadowkeep as they let us melt bosses too quickly and without any real thought on how we were tackling encounters. Finally, we have Tommy's Matchbook, an auto rifle that is very similar to Touch of Malice, where the user shoots rounds and will burn damage at the cost of dealing double damage. So you do get hurt, but you do double damage. There's just no infinite reload. It's not nearly as powerful as Touch of Malice, but is definitely a welcome revamp to an old exotic idea. I think Touch of Malice could have a place one day among the returned Destiny 2 exotics, but I also want to see new exotics that slay out and add a nice spin. But I won't lie, Touch of Malice was the primary weapon that created a space where the primary exotic was worth using on bosses, and I really do miss that. What do you think? Should Touch of Malice return? Why or why not? Anyways, I think the point of this video is to shed some light on some awesome guns of old while showing what an exotic quest is all about and why Destiny exotics are so dang special. If you did enjoy, a like would be greatly appreciated as well as a subscription. You can follow me and watch me get footage, talk about the state of the game, and make tinfoil hat conspiracies on Twitch. That link will be at the top of the description. Anyways, shamelessness aside, I hope you have a great day and enjoy some bloopers. Peace.
An additional round in the magazine, as well as a huge boost for the reload speed. So I'm going to show you this thing without. I also wanted to note that this weapon's fire rate is increased significantly and fires full auto.
I can't wait for the full auto.
Oh, fuck off. Did I unmute?
Bro, we all let it roll, dude.
Where's that at? Dude, he's literally gaining health. What the f- Every time!
What the- Mine didn't even do any damage right there.
If you do- Okay, listen.
What the fuck? He's gaining health from this gun!
Dude. I'm going in.
All right, I'm gonna go hear the weight room band. All right, weight room band. All right, weight room band. I need from the top.
Yes. From the top. Okay, singer, start.
Evan.
Yes. I will never go into the weight room again.